Good morning, welcome back. So today we're going to switch gears a little bit. Yesterday was mainly about circuits and reversible computation. Today I want to show to you some actual quantum algorithms. And we want to start small by looking at a very simple algorithm. Maybe you get a feeling for what's really going on in that case. And then we're going to look at the factoring algorithm, and then quickly afterwards a generalization of the underlying principle behind the factoring algorithm. That's called hidden subgroup problem. In a sense, you want to kind of forget something in that approach. You want to forget something that's annoying. It's an offset that you want to forget. Later in the talk, I hope I get the time to address that. I'm going to talk about kind of the opposite, a problem where you want to find an offset. You're very interested in the offset, and the question is how to find it. Right? One problem about forgetting an offset, the other one about finding an offset. So roughly, that's how hopefully it will play out. Deutsch's problem is a very simple problem, and we will see a quantum algorithm for that. It just needs 2 qubits. And then factoring these hidden shift problems I mentioned. So last time we saw that if you want to implement a function from n bits to m bits on a quantum computer, we can do so. Even if the function is non-reversible, it can be quite anything. It can be from 100 bits to 1 bit. It can be from 1 bit to 100 bit. It doesn't matter. We can always implement it reversibly using the following trick. Instead of implementing the function directly, you embed it into a bigger function, and that bigger function just remembers the inputs. Right? So you remember your input, and you compute the output. From that, you can always uncompute. Right? You can always go back to the input because you still carry around all that baggage about x. So Bennett showed that you can compute this function f, provided you have a circuit for f, for little f, you can compute capital F. And he gave a direct relation between the cost for little f and for big F. Right? So if little f costs you k gates, gates here means universal, like gates from a universal gate set, like and not, for instance, then your capital F can be computed using 2k plus m reversible gates. Okay? That's not too bad. It's just a blow up of essentially a factor of 2. And yesterday we saw how to keep the space also in check, like so it doesn't get out of bound. So today we're going to use that in a quantum fashion. So in order to do that, it helps to just restate the same statement, computing f like this. Let's state it in a quantum mechanical fashion. So instead of working on x comma y, kind of tuples, we work on kets. That really labels just now basis states. You get a basis state x, basis state y. And it turns out that you can even run it on a general input y here instead of 0, and produce, instead of f of x, you can produce y plus f of x. That's actually quite easy to see, because if you remember the Bennett trick, it computed, and then it applied a controlled not copy of the output into that other register, and then it ran the computation backwards. So instead of running that on the zero input, if you run it on an input y, it will just perform y plus f of x. Okay? So that's very nice, and that thing always, it's very easy to reverse it, right? You basically just run it again, then you get y plus f of x, and you get y back, right? Because taking an x or twice just brings you back to where you came from. So that shows that that's actually a reversible map, and you can use that to implement f on a quantum computer. So what is Deutsch's problem? The Deutsch's problem is very simple to explain. You're given a Boolean function, so it's a function from 1 bit to 1 bit. And you want to know if the function has this property, f of 0 is equal to f of 1. What does that mean? Well, it means the function is constant, right? If f of 0, there's only two points, really. And if the values are the same, then the function is constant. So you want to know, is the function constant or is it not constant? Okay? Simple enough. There are only 4 functions from 1 bit to 1 bit. Right? In general, if you have n bits, you get more functions, clearly, right? Anybody know how many functions you get from n bits to 1 bits? Is it like 5 or n? 2n? Can I get more? 2 to the 2 to the n. Yeah, that's good. That's the correct answer. So if you have n bits, you didn't set it, said it? Okay, sorry. If you have n bits, there are 2 to the power 2 to the n functions from these n bits to 1 bit. So that grows actually doubly exponential in the number of functions, in the number of bits, all right? And it's actually a quick way to see that is just write down the truth table of your function. It has 2 to the n binary strings. And for each binary string, you can pick either 0 or 1. That gives you 2 choices per entry, per row, and a 2 to the n rows, so that gives you 2 to the power 2 to the n. Okay. All right, so here we have kind of a baby version of that, just 1 bit, and then you get 4 functions, because you get kind of 2 to the 2 to the 1, right? So you get 2 to the 2, it's 4. So you get these 4 functions. That's the function that always maps to 0. That's the function that always maps to 1. These two guys are constant. And these two guys are the 2 non-constant functions. Conveniently, in case of just 1 bit, a function is either balanced, or say, it's one of these two guys, right? It takes the same outputs, the same number of times, or it's constant. Later we're going to see that there's this, like it falls into two classes naturally, constant functions versus balanced functions. But as you go to more than 2 bits, not every function falls into these two classes, right? It's just a tiny fraction of all functions are either constant or balanced. In case of 1 bit, it's actually exhausting the whole space. A function is either constant or balanced, there's nothing else, right? So, but let me show you first how to actually solve that problem to distinguish whether a function is constant or non-constant, okay? And we can do so on a quantum computer with actually just 1 query to the function. So what's a query? A query means like how often do you actually have to evaluate the function in order to know something. So every time you want to evaluate it, that costs you one unit. It's called a query. Classically, you need 2 queries. It's not enough to just query the function once to know the answer. Okay, can you see why? So if you for instance, query the function at 0, right? So if it's that case, well, you will get the value 0. If it's that case, you get the value 1. If that's case, value 0. And that case, value 1. So suppose you queried at 0 and you got 0. Then you still don't know which is which, right? Because it could have potentially been that case, or it could be potentially have been that case. The same for 1. So clearly, just querying the function once is not enough. It's a bit surprising that actually, quantum mechanically, it's enough to query it only once. Right? So really digest that. That's really something you can do quantumly, but you cannot possibly do classically. Right? If your life depended on it, you have to evaluate that function. You have to know is it constant or balanced. And you just have 1 shot. Classically, you're sunk. Right? With 50% probability, you will lose that game. Quantumly, you can always win that game. And I'm going to show you how to do that next. Okay, any questions up to that point? Okay, so how to do that? So first of all, the way we compute the function is, as I mentioned in the beginning, right? Using this reversible version of the function, which we call UF. So UF does XY goes to X comma Y plus F of X. So we're not gonna use that kind of on general inputs. We're gonna use it on a very special input. We initialize Y in that state, okay? And then we run that circuit. So the first question is, why do we do that, and what happens if we do it? So the reason why we do it is, if you run UF on that input, you will, instead of computing it into the ket, you will compute it into the phase. And that's very useful for a number of algorithms, because intuitively, if you have stuff in the phases, it's easier to cancel out things and get interference. Ultimately, quantum computing is really about using interferences to cancel out bad passes and get good paths only, right? Computational passes. You want to get rid of bad ones and you want to keep good ones. And how can you do that if everything is in a basis state? It's not really possible. So that's why it's quite useful to sometimes be able to transport information from a basis state into amplitudes. Okay, this phase kickback trick allows you to do that. So if you initialize the Y register in that state, let's see what happens if you apply UF. Okay, so there are 2 cases, 0 and 1. Let's just split them apart. So if it's 0, you get x f of x, because 0 plus f of x is the same as f of x. If you get 1, well, you get 1 plus f of x. Okay? And you get a minus sign in front of that just because of this thing here. But now you can rewrite it like this by just looking at the 2 cases, right? f of x. Like f of x can be either 0, right? Then this is 1, and the phase in front of it is a minus one, all right? And this is the same as you get if this f of x is zero. If f of x is zero, this thing is not here, and you get the minus one out here, okay? If f of x, conversely, is one, you flip this guy, you get zero, but you have the minus one hanging outside here, okay? So if f of x is one, you get minus one, if f of x is one, you get minus zero from that part, which is exactly what you get here, right? You get a zero, and you get the minus one here. And the same holds true for the other pass. If that's zero, you will get f of x zero. You don't pick up the phase here, you get zero. And if it's one, all right, you get a minus one from here, and the minus one, you cancel out, you get one. It's kind of mind-boggling to just explain it here, standing here. It really helps to just write that down on a piece of paper, if you've never done that, and you will see how the phases neatly arrange. And it looks a little bit like magic, why this works, but it's really a key, that's really a key trick to understand how to get information from basis states into phases. Okay, any questions about that? So, very important trick. Once you're here, once you're at that line, you realize, oh, that's kind of nice because I kind of recycle the state. Okay, you started with that state, it was unentangled, it was a product state, and after applying the operation, again, you get a product state. It factors out, okay? And what you gained is you get the X register. It's untouched. You get that part. It's untouched. The only thing that changed is that phase here, and you picked it up by just applying that UF gate. All right? It looks like a global phase. So, and global phases are bad because we cannot detect them. But really, it's not a global phase because you can run that thing on a superposition of different axes. Right? And if you do that, then you pick up different phases for different elements of that superposition, so you can produce relative phases in that way. Okay, and that's what we're going to do next. We're going to run that on a superposition of different axes. Okay, so to quickly summarize this, if you start on x and this state here, you get you get x back, but you pick up the phase up here, and you get that state. All right. So let's change the circuit a little bit. Let's, instead of running it on x, let's run it on superposition of two axes, namely 0 and 1. Right? So if you start with 0 here, you get 0 plus 1. And here we start with the same state as before, because if you feed in a 1 state into a Hadamard, you get exactly the state 0 minus 1. Okay, so what happens then? And we can again do the computation, all the steps. The hard work we already did on the previous slide, namely that UF here will compute the function into the phase. Okay, and that's what happens here. We leave this guy alone. We just like separate out the two cases here, the zero case and the one case. And then if we compute F, well, we'll pick up F of zero for that branch, and we'll pick up F of one for that branch. Okay, and then we just recombine the two results, and we can rewrite it in that form. Okay, it's just like expanding these terms and recollecting them, and then you get this. Now this is a global phase that doesn't really matter, but here you see something interesting happening. So you get f of zero plus f of one in the exponent, okay, and like doing another Hadamard transform will compute that back into the basis state, right? Because well, if it's 0 plus 1, it will map it to 0. If it's 0 minus 1, it will map it to 1. Right? And like whether it is minus 1 is exactly given by that function value. So applying a Hadamard transform to that state gives you exactly that state. Right? So it looks, again, completely useless. So why did we do all these steps? The point is, if you measure this state now in the computational basis, if you measure the first bit, actually, we'll get some useful information. And what is that information? Well, if you measure a zero, we will know for sure that f of zero must be equal to f of one, right? If you measure here and you see a zero, you know the function must be constant. And if you measure one, you know the function must be non-constant, right? And well, what did we gain or what happened here? Well, we used only one query to f to do that. Right? So one query means we used f, and we invoked it only one time, and at the end of the day, we knew for sure if the function was constant or not. Okay, that's a surprising thing happening here, and clearly it must have to do with these phases, right? If you don't have any cancellations in your algorithm, the algorithm is a general principle, it's not going to be a good quantum algorithm, right? There must be some kind of cancellations, and here you see them in the kind of purest form they can ever. It doesn't get as simple as that in general in the quantum algorithm, but here you can see how you can actually use these phases to cancel out stuff. Okay, I'm yapping too much, I think. Any questions about that algorithm? Who has seen this before? Okay, great. So let's shift gears again. By the way, this algorithm is just a special case of a more general idea, like namely to distinguish between constant functions and balanced functions. The same idea will work in principle, but I mentioned already kind of it's a big promise. A function in general, like if you pick any function, it will be neither balanced nor constant, right? So there's a big promise in here, namely that your function is either one of the two cases. And it turns out that this is kind of even too much of a promise. Even a classical algorithm will now be able to figure these two cases out. Not a deterministic one. A deterministic algorithm will need an exponential number of queries. And if you want to read more about this, look into either the textbook by Nielsen Chung or the one by Kay et al. If you have a deterministic algorithm, it will need an exponential number of queries. A quantum algorithm just needs, again, n, like a very small number. In that case, it's n. But a classical probabilistic algorithm can also do it in polynomial time. Right? So that doesn't provide a separation between classical and quantum. Later in this talk, I will show you some problems for which you can actually prove a separation, where classically you will need an exponential number of queries, and quantum you can do it in polynomial. Again, you have to take these results with a little bit of a grain of salt, because that's not an absolute statement. It's always with respect to some function you're not allowed to analyze further. Right? It's sometimes in our field called an oracle. So an oracle is a function which you can query, but you're not allowed to study it or look inside. Okay? So there are some problems for which you can show these separations, but they're typically with respect to an oracle. If you could show a separation without an oracle, you would have immediately achieved a major breakthrough in complexity. Right? And I'm sure we hear more about like complexity statements later this week in John's talk or maybe in Peter's talk. So bottom line, typically the results in quantum computing are either black box statements with reference to an oracle, right? Then you can get separations, but then it's not clear whether that applies to actual real world problems. Or you get statements about real world problems, but then it's very difficult to get speed ups. Sometimes we get speed ups, but we don't know if that's the best possible classical algorithm. Right? And a good example for that is actually the next thing I wanted to talk about, the factoring algorithm. Okay, so factoring is the problem. You start with an integer and you want to find at least one of the prime factors. If you can find one, you can recurse, right? You divide it off and keep doing it. So the best known classical algorithm has a sub-exponential runtime. Okay, so sub-exponential means it's not as bad as trying all the factors, but that function clearly grows faster than any polynomial. Right? Sometimes that's called quasi-polynomial, but it's pretty bad. If n gets around, say, 1,000 bits, has any chance to solve that on even a large cluster. Yesterday, John made that very nice, told a little anecdote that if you wanted to do it with this algorithm for a 2,000-bit number, you would have to cover one quarter of the area of North America with servers that keep sieving these numbers, and it would cost you an energy of 1 million trillion. That was the price, I guess. $1 million trillion, and the energy was 1,000 terawatts or something. So that's kind of, if you just use that algorithm, it scales very poorly in terms of the number of bits of n. But it's and the problem has a very long tradition. Many people looked at the problem. It's not guaranteed, though, that there's no algorithm. Right? We don't know. There's no proof that there is no efficient factoring algorithm. In fact, tomorrow there could be a smart person who comes up with a new factoring algorithm. Nobody knows, a classical factoring algorithm. I want to show you in a nutshell how that works, and I want to focus more on the idea itself, not on the technical details. I want to show you what is the principle that allows you to factor. Okay, so the quantum way to factor is by reduction to a so-called period finding problem. You could do that classically too, but it's not very useful classically, because classically it's hard to find a period of a function if the period is exponentially long, right? Because you would have to kind of intuitively, you would have to wait exponentially long until you get back to zero. A quantum computer can do that in some sense. Quantum computer can come back to zero and even do it many, many times. And you can use that to find a period of a function. It's not as simple as I make it sound here. You have to work a little bit harder to find a period. But the basic idea is to, instead of factor the number directly, you go a detour. And a detour is to use the number n to first define a period finding problem. Then you solve that, and then you come back to factoring the number. So how that works is as follows. You start with a number n you want to factor, and you pick a random a modulo n. Okay, so just pick a random random number between 0 and n. Clearly, you don't pick 0. You also pick you don't pick 1. But you might even pick 2, right? In 2 might work in some cases. And then you set up this function. It's the modular exponentiation map. Right? On input x, you compute a to the x mod n. Using classical arithmetic, this function can be computed with a efficient circuit. Right? You will need some adders. You will need multipliers. You will take the multipliers to make an exponentiation map and so on. But overall, that whole thing will be an efficient classical circuit. And using that circuit, you can implement that map. And we've seen last time, in last lecture, if you have a classical circuit, you can always make it reversible. Okay? So we can even do it for this operation. It's a pretty contrived one. If you really sit down and count the operations and figure out how to implement that, it's quite contrived. But it's possible, and people have done that actually. They wrote down circuits for the exponentiation map, and then they wrote down the reversible version of it, and they checked how to implement it on a bunch of qubits, and even on a quantum computer which is constrained in its architecture. Say, if you only have nearest neighbor interactions, how does it look then, and so on. So all that can be done. So that function you can compute efficiently on a quantum computer, and you will need polylog n operations. In fact, you can quite easily do it with a cubic number of operations using a naive method to do the multiplications. And then having several multiplications, you can make an exponentiation. But you can bring that down to roughly n square, log n, log log n, something like that, using fast methods for multiplication. Nobody really does that because those methods only are really useful once n gets really large. But in principle, one could even study fast methods for multiplication. Okay, so how does it work now, the reduction? So the order of an element, so our number a that we picked, is defined as the smallest r, so you do return back to 1. All right, at some value of r, you have to return to 1, because the order of any element is finite. So r is defined as the smallest number, so that happens. And that means that function here is really a periodic function. So if you shift an x by this r here, right, what will happen is you will get a to the x plus r, and then you can split that into a to the x times a to the r. A to the r was 1, so it doesn't harm you, so you just get a to the x. So that shows that function is a periodic function with a period exactly given by r. Okay, why do we do this? Well, we'll be able to find the period r. Once we have found it, we can actually infer a factor of n by the following trick. So you have to kind of hope that the r is an even number. It turns out if you analyze it closely, that will happen with constant probability. So if it didn't happen, you just repeat it a few times. With very high probability, you will catch a case where r is even. If you have a case where r is even, you can take a to the r over 2. Okay, r over 2 in that case is an integer. You can just raise it to that. And then you can compute a factor of n by making a simple GCD computation with respect to this a to the r over 2 minus 1 and a to the r over 2 plus 1. Okay, that equation then gives you an equation about factors of n, and you can extract knowledge from computing a GCD. So I want to show you the kind of what is the feel, like really look and feel of that algorithm. What does it make it work? Right? How does this work? So what happens is when you compute the function is, you have all these axes on this exponential size range, and you compute all the corresponding function values, and I plotted it here kind of two-dimensional. So you see that the thing is periodic, right? Once you hit the period r of that element, And here I chose, oh, there's a typo. This should be 2 to the x mod 164. Okay, I'm going to fix that before I give you the final version. I chose a to be 2, and that was the number n. And you see there's a periodic pattern here. So the question is, how can we extract that period, right? So we want to know r, how can we get r? If you have periodic functions, it's always a good idea to look at the Fourier spectrum, because it will have very sharp peaks at certain points. Okay? So that's what we're going to do next. So the Fourier transform is this matrix. There are many ways to think of a Fourier transform. A kind of very pedestrian way is to think of it as a matrix. Turns out to be a unitary matrix. That omega here is a primitive nth root of unity, and this is a matrix of size n by n. And if you have a signal, here's a real signal of a picture, you can compute the Fourier transform and you can study what happens here. In that case, it's not a periodic picture, so you don't expect to see any kind of periodic structure in the Fourier transform, but you can nevertheless see some features. For instance, typically if you take an image of a person or like a scene, like a real world image, you will typically have a lot of low frequency components in there. That's just because nature is quite continuous, right? You don't have any abrupt changes in nature. Look at that wall, for instance. It's pretty uniform. Then there's a little change. There's bricks here. Then it's again wall, but it's pretty uniform. And all these uniform things, they typically correspond to, they contribute to all these low frequency components, right? In a two-dimensional Fourier transform, typically it's plotted in a way that's centered at zero, right? So here are the low frequency guys. Everything up here is high frequencies. And high frequencies correspond more or less to some noisy stuff in your signal. Or it can correspond to sharp edges. So if you have in an image a sharp edge between white and dark, right, that corresponds to a very steep like slope. Fourier transform of something like that, a very steep part, is something like sine x divided by x, sync, right? And that contributes to higher order frequencies. So no surprise that we see some of them out here. But also no surprise that we don't see any periodic structure because the pre-image didn't have any. Any questions? Just to illustrate what people use Fourier spectral methods for. It's going to be very useful for us in quantum. And why? Well, okay, quick remark here. There are many kinds of Fourier transforms people use in quantum computing. That's just one. The Hadamard transform we saw yesterday is another case of a Fourier transform, but it's for a different group. Okay, so this is for the cyclic group where you shift modulo n. The Hadamard transform is for the group of the hypercube. Okay, time permitting, I'm going to talk a little bit more about other Fourier transforms for other kind of group. Okay, so a Fourier transform, the nice thing on a quantum computer, essentially it's for free. You can basically instantaneously compute a Fourier transform. The cost is polylogarithmic in n, and that's very little, right? It kind of, you can many times just neglect it compared to the cost of the rest of the algorithm. So, and the trick is to use a factorization that's actually known from classical signal processing. It's called the Culey-Tukey factorization. It's a factorization into a product of tensor products and some very sparse matrices. And it turns out that it's a very good factorization for the quantum computer, because on the quantum computer, all these tensor products are basically for free, right? The only thing that a tensor product costs you is the cost for one of the factors. Okay, in that case, one of the factors is even an identity, so you don't have to do anything. And here you have to do a DFT of size 2, which is just a Hadamard transform. And that actually turns out to scale up to a Fourier transform of length 2 to the n. And you get this circuit, which you find in all the textbooks, right? So you get a Hadamard transform that needs to be applied to all of the qubits, but then you need some kind of corrections, fixing some phases. And in the previous slide, that was that matrix here, right? In signal processing, they're called twiddle factors. So these twiddle factors are what you need to do here and so on. And those are the things that are a little bit annoying when you want to implement that fault tolerantly on top of an error correcting code, because you need finer and finer rotations, and to implement them, it's difficult, right? Yesterday we talked about the difficulty of implementing a T gate. That's kind of the same problem, but on steroids, because the T-gate is a pi over 8 rotation. Now you need to do a pi over 16, 32, and so on. It gets finer and finer if you want to do a Fourier transform with a very high precision. There are many tricks. You can sometimes just prune it. You don't have to go all the way to all these phase factors. Depending on your problem, you might get away with a little bit less. But essentially, that's at least the way I think about it. A Fourier transform is a very cheap operation on a quantum computer, almost instantaneous. If you come from optics, a lens will do a Fourier transform for you, right? You have a planar wave, say, of light. And then if you put a lens and you look at the focal point of the lens will compute a Fourier transform. Also in essentially an instantaneous fashion, right? It's just propagation of light and you have done your Fourier transform. The way I like to think about this is a quantum computer can do a similar thing. It takes a signal here and then it runs a few very simple steps and at the end it produces the Fourier transform almost immediately, okay? All right, so how is it useful for us? So again, we have set up this state, the superposition of all pairs x, f of x. We could do so by just running the circuit for exponentiation, but in superposition. Okay, so first we prepare all the inputs, then we evaluate it, we get the state. So what we can do now is we could measure this second register. Okay, what does that, why is that useful? Well, the function f will have a lot of collisions, right? We choose, actually, we choose x here to range from a range that's much larger than n, right? N is the range our objects really live in, but we want to discover some periodic structure, so it's a good idea to just continue f a few times, right? So the periodic structure actually starts to emerge. And a good choice for m is just to use n square, right? So if n is an m bit number, then choose m to be 2m, right? Just double the number of bits that are required for n. And that's going to be the precision, the number of bits to work with for x. Okay, so evaluate this, measure this. The resulting state looks like this. I'm discarding now that second register because it has been measured. It's classical. You can discard it. The state on the first register now looks like this. And if you look closely, you will see some offset. Okay, and you will then see a repeating pattern. Right. So there's offset here. You cannot really control. That's related to what value you measured out here, okay? So next time you do the same thing, you will measure a different result with very high probability, and you will get a different offset x0, okay? And next time you do it with very high probability, you get again a different offset. That's what I mentioned in the beginning of the intro. That's a problem where you have an offset, and it's very annoying. And you would like to get rid of that offset. If the offset was not here, we could just Fourier transform the signal and know something about the period. If you just sample from this signal alone, you will actually get no information at all about the period, because next time that comb here, right, will be offset somewhere else, and you get a different value. But overall, if you just sample from this comb, you do that for many runs, you will just sample uniformly from everything. You don't get any information. So Shor's idea was, hey, why don't we just get rid of this offset by looking at the Fourier transform? And the Fourier transform of a signal, the Fourier spectrum, is kind of, well, it's not invariant under shifts, but the absolute value of the Fourier coefficients are, right? So the power spectrum is shift invariant. So if, and what a measurement does is just nothing but sampling from the power spectrum, right? So if you do the Fourier transform and measure, you will observe a Fourier coefficient with probability absolute value square of that Fourier coefficient. So it's kind of insensitive to these shifts, right? And that's a good thing in our case, because we want to forget about the offset. So the idea is do the Fourier transform and then measure the Fourier spectrum. Okay, so here again, it's exactly that idea. We have set up that state, right, by running that simple procedure of just evaluating the exponentiation map on all the inputs and measuring. We can set up the state and it looks like this. And so now the idea, Shor's idea was just compute the Fourier transform. And it will look like this. It's again a sequence of these delta functions. Okay, that's like a sequence of delta functions. It will be again a sequence of delta functions. The period relates to the inverse period of that function, right? So the higher frequency you have in your original function, the lower frequency you get here, all right? And the offset will go away. Well, it will not go away completely. It will go into a linear phase that you get on top of this signal, okay? So if you get a different x0 here, you will get a different phase. It's a complex phase, but by measuring, you will not feel that phase, right? You take the absolute value square, so that just doesn't matter, and so you will sample a multiple of one over r. So then Shor had to do some more work because he had to find out a way how to infer r from one of these multiples, right? You get essentially a multiple of one over r. The question is, how do we get r back? And an additional difficulty is that you don't get it precisely located as at a multiple of 1 over r, but slightly there's a slight jitter in there. Okay? I'm not going to show you how to get rid of this jitter in this talk, but it's essentially a classical post-processing procedure. Once you measured something quite close to one of these peaks, you can use a classical algorithm called continued fraction expansion of that number that you measured. And that will at some point, as one of the approximations in that algorithm, it will have exactly a multiple of 1 over r. And then you can find r from there by just a simple inversion of r. All right? But what I'd rather do is I want to stay in that picture because that's a really key idea. And want to show you what people did to generalize it. I mean, it's nice that it works for factoring, but that seems like such a powerful idea. The question is, can we use that for some other problems too, right? It seems useful, right? You have a periodic function, take the Fourier transform, it forgets about the offset, and now we want to just sample from here and learn something about the function, like kind of general period finding. Does it work, or what? If it doesn't work, what is the catch? Okay, I'm going to skip this. I have here, that's going to be in the materials. I'll just give it along. But it's a resource estimate if you want to factor an n-bit number, how many qubits you would need if you do a very crude estimate on the error correction part and the operation part. But it's polynomial on a quantum computer. So I want to talk about this idea to find periods. Unfortunately, now we know things are not so easy. So we basically ran into a brick wall at some point. People have studied that maybe for 10 years or so. They tried to find good ways to leverage this period finding property. And I think now it's fair to say that we don't know how to do it, really. So we kind of hit the wall. And I want to show you why. And, that's one of the most tantalizing problems in that field of trying to solve a problem by reducing it to a periodicity problem. So people were looking for problems that would naturally fit, and that was the prime example. So the so-called graph isomorphism problem. So given two graphs, and you want to know is there a reordering of these nodes so that you can map one to the other. Right? It looks maybe not so difficult if you look at small graphs. It looks quite easy, actually. But once that scales up and you get a lot of vertices and a lot of edges, the problem, it's not known to be in polynomial time. In fact, there's some complexity statements are known. So it's probably not an NP-complete problem. It sits in a class called NP-intersect co-AM, which is in some sense similar to NP-intersect co-NP, where factoring sits, but not quite. A complexity theorist would probably say, no, that's a very different class. But it's kind of low in that so-called hierarchy of complexity classes, and therefore very unlikely to be NP-complete. Right? There would be a major surprise if that were an NP-complete problem. And there's no polynomial time algorithm known for that problem. In fact, the best classical algorithm has, again, a sub-exponential runtime. So everything smells a little bit like the factoring situation, classically. Right? You get sub-exponential runtime here. It sits in a class similar to NP-intersect co-NP. And that's why people got really excited at some point. They were looking at that problem and tried to reduce it to a period finding problem. Let me give you an idea why that doesn't work so well. So the framework that was developed is the so-called hidden subgroup problem framework, and it's a framework to capture period finding problems. So think of that function f to be a generalization of the modular exponentiation. But now we don't want to do it just for the integers mod n, we want to do it for any group. And G can be any group, okay? And instead of having, again, the integers as a target, we just say S is any target set. The target set doesn't have to, the structure of the target set doesn't seem to play a very big role anyways. And in the exponentiation map, it was this order that we tried to find. So now we abstract that, the order becomes a subgroup of that group. Okay, the order kind of defines a subgroup of the group mod n. Now we want to find a subgroup of that G. And in order to even have a hope to find that subgroup, we must impose some conditions on F, of course. Somehow that H must be implicitly defined by F. And this is the way it works in the hidden subgroup problem. So we promise that this function F takes the same value on H Like all the elements of H will map to the same value. Okay, before that was that A of power R, A of power 2R, A of power 3R, they all map to 1. And likewise, if you shift that a little bit, you take A of R plus 1, A of 2R plus 1, and so on, they all again map to the same thing. So that was generalized to saying that F is constant on each coset. So you pick a coset, you get the same value. For that coset, they all map to the same value here. And you must have that different cosets map to different values. Because if they don't, then finding this H, well, there's a special case then you can set up where finding this is really just a search problem, an unstructured search problem, right? If you allow that the values could potentially be the same, then all these cosets could map to the same, and this one would be different, then finding H would be essentially searching, and there are like bounds known on searching, right? Essentially, you cannot get a speed up for search. So that was another very natural like assumption, and it's also true for the exponentiation map, so hey, why not make this extra assumption? So it turns out now this difficulty of the hidden subgroup problem crucially depends on what G is. So first, the good news is that whenever your group is commutative, right, and a special case is, for instance, the integers itself, or, excuse me, or if you take a group which is commutative and you take a direct product with itself, right, this is like a two-dimensional version of the group, or if you take the group of real numbers, all these groups are commutative, and the intuition is whenever you have something commutative, the same Fourier approach will work again. It's not that you get like R goes to 1 over R, it's a little bit more contrived than that, but not too much more contrived. You basically can define a notion of a dual, and each subgroup H will have a dual subgroup, right? In some sense, for the factoring case, taking a dual is like going from R to 1 over R. If you have a two-dimensional version, taking a dual is taking something perpendicular. So if you have a two-dimensional group, G is say ZP times ZP, and your H is just a line in here, then taking the dual will take that to a perpendicular line. Okay, so this is going to be H perp. And this is really going to be perpendicular the way you would intuitively expect it, right? If that were a real function, really a line would go perfectly to a perpendicular one. If it's over a finite field like this, well, it will go to a finite field analog of perpendicular. But you get the idea. You get a pairing between a group and its dual group. So that's all very nice. But unfortunately, these things do not carry through to groups that are non-abelian. So one of the really challenging ones is kind of a not very difficult looking one at first, the so-called dihedral group. It's pretty close to being abelian, right? You make a small extension of an abelian group and you get these dihedral groups. But in a sense, that's already kind of the worst as it gets. And if you could do that, if you could solve the hidden subgroup problem for these dihedral groups, you would immediately solve some interesting problems in lattice theory, like finding the closest vector to a lattice point, stuff like that, for which no classical algorithm is known for a wide range of lattices. So the thing I mentioned before, the graph isomorphism problem, it also relates to a hidden subgroup problem for the so-called permutation group, the group of all permutations. It's very large. It scales like n factorial if you have Sn here. But people for a long time had a big hope that that's a good approach to tackle any hidden subgroup problem, is kind of to do free analysis and then we're done. But I want to give you just a flavor why this doesn't work. Well, first there was a positive result. In a paper in the end 90s, people realized that there is enough information in these states. So if you generalize from period finding to this hidden subgroup approach, you get so-called coset states. It's the states you get by just running the map F on a superposition, measuring, then you get a quantum state. And now you could take that quantum state, take many copies of it, and do some giant entangling measurement on top of it, right? And then you try to infer what the group is. In that case, I wrote it for that graph automorphism problem where you get like a permuted version of the automorphism group of a graph, take several copies of that. And it has been shown that in a paper by Ettinger, Hoyer, and Knill, that a polynomial number of of these coset states are enough to infer. Polynomial means polynomial in the input size, and the input size in that case is the logarithm of the group size. Okay, for factoring, it was the number of bits you needed for the number n, which is log n. In general, if you have a group with g elements, it's log g, that's the input size. So in general, log g are enough. In case of the symmetric group, it means n log n, which is log of n factorial. Our copies are enough to infer the answer. But the catch is, nobody knows how to implement this entangling measurement. And people spend some time figuring out ways to do it. There's a few ideas out there how these boxes can be broken down, but not many ideas are around. And in a sense, it's bad to deal with very big boxes. It would be nice to deal with very small boxes. Kind of, that's very natural, right? In case of the Shor algorithm, it deals with only one box at a time. You take a box, Fourier transform it, measure, next box. Okay. We could think of these Ettinger-Hoyer-Knill measurements, but they need giant boxes, right? They take many of the coset states, operate on them at once, and then infer the answer. Intuitively, this thing here implements a pure VM, distinguishing between many, many different pure states, and these pure states become almost orthogonal if you go to a high enough space, right? So you work in a tensor product space where suddenly things become more and more orthogonal for different subgroups. So you want to distinguish different H's. If the two subgroups are different, they will correspond to almost orthogonal vectors. So there's got to be a pure VM which separates them. But we don't know how to do this. That case is kind of okay. So the idea was maybe we could interpolate here by looking at larger and larger boxes. Maybe first we look at two at a time, then we look at three at a time, and then we kind of just keep going that way. Maybe ultimately we find a way to do this. Unfortunately, the single register thing turned out to be impossible for graph isomorphism. And then also the case of two turned out to be impossible. And ultimately, it was possible to show that even if you have just a little bit less than n log n, so if you have little o of n log n, many of these boxes, there's just not enough information in that to infer what the subgroup is. Okay, that required some analysis, like probabilistic methods were used to really make the analysis that no measurement will work. Basically, the algorithm designer, like how many minutes? 10? 10, thanks. The algorithm designer has a huge degree of freedom, right? It can come up with any measurement here, and the task is to show that no matter what the algorithm designer does, it will not solve the problem. So it required some probabilistic methods to study that. Let me maybe quickly give you an idea how the proof worked. So so it's helpful to look at graph automorphism problems. It's just for technical reason, it's kind of nice to reduce. And let's look at the symmetric group, the permuting the vertices of the graph. So if you take a permutation and permute a graph, then that's a given graph. Then you get that the automorphism group is a hidden subgroup, because whatever an automorphism is, you will not change it. Right? You have gamma. If you permute it and you picked an automorphism of the graph, you will get the same graph. So it's a period group of this map going from the permutations to the graph. Okay, so if you evaluate this map in superposition that just takes a permutation and permutes the graph, and you measure the second register, you end up with a coset of the automorphism group. Okay? So that generalizes what we had before with this train of delta peaks. Now it's, well, a shifted automorphism group. The automorphism group itself are some permutations, whatever. It's just a bag of elements, really. There's no nice structure like peaks. But what is nice is you will know for sure you will always get a shifted version of that automorphism group. Okay, so the question is, can we compute H from a few of these guys? For different pi's, of course. Yeah. Next time we do that, we get a different pi. And so in the analysis, it helps to look at a special case where your gamma is actually of a very specific form. It's not a general graph. It's a graph that is made up from two pieces, and the two pieces have no automorphisms themselves. So you only get two cases. You have that the two pieces were the same, they were isomorphic. Then that big graph has an auto, order two, it has an automorphism, and there will be only one, and it will have order two. Or they were not the same, then that big piece has no automorphisms at all. Why is it helpful? Well, it helps you to really narrow down the essence of the problem. And so instead of dealing with any graph, you narrow it down to a nice class of graphs, which is still enough to capture the general case. And you know that that graph here that you cooked up has either no automorphisms or exactly one and one of order two. And that problem is really a hard one. If you could distinguish these two cases, you would be all set. You could do graph isomorphism. That would be a major problem. You would solve a major problem, right? So all you have is you get that map. You want to find out, is the hidden subgroup a trivial group or is it an order two group? You don't even have to find this element that takes you from one half to the other. It would be enough to know whether it's order two or order one. But it turns out that exactly this problem is difficult to solve. To show it, let me speed up a little bit in that part. Feel free to ask me after the talk about that if you want to learn more about it. But in some sense, this whole approach, this Fourier sampling approach, it works only for a restricted set of groups. And it, in particular, it failed for that symmetric group out here. Okay, so you get, there's a notion of a Fourier transform that generalizes from the abelian case, from the good old Fourier transform, to any group. Whatever the group is, you can always write down a unitary matrix that computes the Fourier transform for that group. Right? Here's the definition. And it will have a nice property that it will decompose the group operation into very small blocks. Right? So if you shift your signal, before in the abelian case, what you got were little phases, right? The Fourier spectrum got multiplied by little phases if you shift your signal. In the general case, if you shift your group, unfortunately, it's not just little phases, you might get blocks. So that's why some blocks here appear. And you might also get them with some multiplicities, which is a little bit annoying. Right? So things get non-commutative in that sense, because larger blocks make things more commutative in some sense, more non-commutative in a sense. So a multi-register algorithm is one that tries to infer H from several tensor products of this. Okay, so we get the state. And then the idea is to just do a Fourier transform of all this, and then see how good we can do. Nobody tells us that this is the only way, but this is a very reasonable way, actually, to process these states. And you might think of it like this. After you do the Fourier transform, things are now block diagonal, and you can focus on one of the blocks, and you can look how well you can distinguish the states that live on these blocks by performing another measurement. Right? So if you're the algorithm designer, it's up to you to write down a basis in which you measure. So the question is there maybe a good basis that distinguishes between different ages? And it turns out, no. So if you have the case of the trivial subgroup, then there's no work to be done. It's known that whatever basis you will pick, you will always get a uniform distribution over all the elements in the basis. Okay? If you have an order two subgroup, again, it's possible to write down the probability to measure one of these elements. It's given by the length of the projection of that vector B that you picked as the algorithm designer, right? It's your basis vector. And this row H here is the coset state for H. It depends on how that B projects into your coset state. 5 minutes, thanks. Okay, so the intuition is for the trivial subgroup, you can always get flat. Hopefully, if you have a good choice of a basis, you will get something that's very non-flat, okay? If it's abelian, you can actually make that happen. You can make it very non-flat. Unfortunately, for the case of graph automorphism and graph isomorphism, both are really the same, you cannot make that happen. Whatever you choose, it will always be very, very close to being flat. The difference between the distribution is measured in terms of the total variation distance, right? That's the L1 distance between the probability distributions. And it's possible to show a very kind of small upper bound here for that total variation distance. That K is the number of copies you need. And it can be shown that F here is a very small number. So you have to crank up that K very high to get something that's constant. And only if the total variation distance is kind of constant, or say 1 over poly, then you have a chance even to distinguish them. Okay, so these two cases where it's order one or some other order. Okay, and then what you get in order, if you expand this expression, you get something that looks like this, or you can bound it quite easily, and you get an expression like this. It looks very horrible. It's like a sum that ranges over all the irreducible representations of that group, and it has here the degrees and some character values of these representations, and it again has here a projection of your vector of your choice into some subspace that's defined by the group. Okay, so the way to analyze this is, and this is where probabilistic methods kick in that I just mentioned a few moments ago, is that you can make a win-win analysis. So instead of looking at all these terms and somehow figuring out what the sum is, you can split it into two regimes. One regime is kind of the small degree irreps, and another regime is the very high degree irreps. And then you get kind of a very structured part and a very unstructured part. Okay, the low degree ones, they are kind of the unstructured part. For low degree irrep, it might quite well happen that this contribution here is large, and then the task is to show that then this thing is small. For high degree irrep, it turns out that this character value is always small. It gets killed by this dimension, and we don't care about that length. It can always be upper bounded by one. Okay, so the idea is to make kind of these two regimes, small degree, high degree regime, and then to bound this overall expression. It's kind of technical. You can look into the stock paper if you're interested in the details. But that's really the idea, to get an upper bound like this. So overall, this can be used to show that you need n log n many coset states to solve graph isomorphism. And so it kind of in a way implies that the methods we looked at so far, they're not good enough for graph isomorphism. So maybe it's a bad idea to reduce graph isomorphism to hidden subgroup in the first place. Nobody knows. Or maybe we should just think about different methods, maybe some kind of ways to pair different coset states, to apply maybe the so-called pretty good measurements that worked in some other cases of some other non-abelian groups, or maybe some yet other methods. So let me close by giving you guys an outlook. That's a pretty bad result, right? Like, we wanted to solve graph isomorphism, but it didn't work. So maybe there's a way to turn it around, to make that lemon and turn it into some lemonade, right? So there is actually a way, and I really like this idea. So there's an idea to define a classical cryptographic primitive, and it uses the idea that there is something that seems to be hard for the quantum computer. Right? We don't know how to do graph isomorphism. Okay, I'm up. Okay, I'm finishing in 1 second. There is something that's hard even for a quantum computer, namely solving graph isomorphism. Nobody knows how to do it, and now we have a little bit of evidence that it's indeed difficult. So can we maybe turn that into a cryptosystem, a classical cryptosystem, completely classical, classical inputs but classical outputs? But now we have an argument that breaking that cryptosystem is even hard if you have a quantum computer. Okay, so it's not actually a cryptosystem. It's not a cipher. It's also not a trapdoor function. It is a one-way function. So one-way function is a function that's very easy and efficient to evaluate, but very difficult to invert. So if you're given any of the outputs, it's going to be very hard to find a pre-image of that output. Okay, so in a paper by Moore, Russell, and Vazirani, the authors came up with such a function, and it's a very nice, easy to state function. Essentially, you just take a matrix, that's your input, and you multiply it with another matrix, and that's the output, that's the function. And then that other matrix is slightly expanding, it has slightly more columns than it has rows, so it slightly expands from the, like if your initial function is n by n, it goes maybe to n plus log square n, right? So slightly expanding, ever so slightly. But they could show that if there was a quantum algorithm that could invert that function, even on a polynomial fraction of inputs, right? Maybe there's a particular input where you can invert it. All right, okay. But like, even if there's a polynomial fraction of these inputs where you could invert it, then you could reduce that to show that there's a polynomial algorithm for graph isomorphism. And for that, we have some evidence that it's very unlikely to exist, right? Because of that previous result like the standard approach for graph isomorphism doesn't work on a quantum computer. That shows that breaking that one-way function on a quantum computer is also, well, unlikely, at least with currently known techniques. Okay, so I want to stop here. Thank you for your attention.